Hello, my dear students. I hope you all are doing fine. Today, I am going to start with the very first chapter of physics, that is motion. It is a very important topic and you must understand it thoroughly and very carefully. So let us all start. What is motion? If I ask you, what is motion? Which is the first word that comes to your mind? I am sure that you all must be thinking motion means movement, or a body is said to be in motion if it is moving. Yes, you are correct. But technically, it's not correct. Why? I will explain you now. Before that, let me tell you one thing, that motion is a relative term. It is not an absolute term. These two words will become clearer with the following example. Now let us understand. If two persons A and B are sitting in a bus and the bus is moving on the road. Okay. If I ask A whether B is moving or at rest, A will say that B is at rest. Now there is a third person C who is standing on the road. If I ask C whether B is moving or at rest, then C will say that the B is moving. To C, B will appear to be moving, but to A, B will appear to be at rest. That means I cannot say absolutely that B is in motion. Neither can I say absolutely that B is at rest. That means whether B is in motion or at rest depends upon the reference point. Means to whom am I asking, whether to A or whether to C. Okay, so it is a relative term. Relative meaning whether I'm asking with respect to A or with respect to C. Okay, so if I randomly say that B is moving and I ask A whether B is moving, he will say no, B is not moving. If I randomly say that B is at rest, C will say no, B is not at rest. So whether B is moving or not depends upon the point of reference. Similarly, we can take another example, mountains. To us, the mountains appear to be at rest, but with respect to sun, the mountains are continuously moving. Why? Because the earth is revolving around the sun continuously. Okay, so now I hope I am clear with the statement motion. A body is said to be in motion if its position changes continuously with respect to a reference point. I have written the definition here. A body is said to be in motion if its position changes continuously with respect to a reference point. Means if with respect to reference point, here if I take C as the reference point, the position of B is changing continuously. So for C, B is in motion. But for A, the position of B is not changing. So for A, B is at rest. Now I hope it is clear that motion is a relative term. Relative term means it depends upon the point of reference, whether the object is at rest or in motion. Now, moving forward, the next concept is one-dimensional motion or rectilinear motion. We will be dealing with two types of motion at your level. The first one is rectilinear motion. I will be explaining you the other types of motion later on. So the first type of motion is one dimensional or rectilinear motion. What is rectilinear motion? The movement of a body along a straight line is called the rectilinear motion or one-dimensional motion. If a body moves along a straight line, then it is said to be undergoing rectilinear motion. It can be to and fro in both the direction. For example, a car moving on a straight road, it undergoes a rectilinear motion. I am saying the word straight road. So, another example can be an apple falling from the tree. It falls in a straight line due to the action of gravity, and hence it is undergoing the rectilinear motion. Rectilinear motion is also called the one-dimensional motion. Now the next topic is physical quantities. What are all these are very small topics, but you have to understand these topics, these basic topics, for the clarity of the chapter. Now the next topic is physical quantities. What is the meaning of physical quantity? The quantities which can be measured are called the physical quantities. There are two types of physical quantities: scalar quantities and the vector quantities. Now, the quantities which can be measured are called the physical quantities. For example, if I take this pen, can you measure the length of this pen? Can you measure the length of this pen? Yes, we can measure the length of this pen. Suppose it comes out to be 10 centimeter, then we will say the length of this pen is 10 centimeter. So length is a physical quantity because it can be measured. Similarly, can you measure your mass? If you stand on a weighing machine, you will get your mass. For example, it comes out to be 50 kg. You will say that your mass is 50 kg. Can you measure it? Yes. So mass is another physical quantity. Now, can you measure light? You cannot measure light. But you can measure the intensity of the light. So intensity of light is a physical quantity. Now these physical quantities are categorized into two types. First is the scalar quantity, second is the vector quantity. As you can see, scalar quantities are the quantities which have only magnitude. However, vector quantities are the quantities which have both direction and magnitude. Let me elaborate it with an example. Suppose I ask you to measure the length of this pen. Whether you start from this side and move to this side, or whether you start from this side and move to this side, in both the cases, the length will come out to be 10 centimeter if it is of 10 centimeter. Is that clear? So in both the cases, the length is coming out to be 10 centimeter. That means it does not depend upon the direction from where you started. If you start from this side and move to this side, or whether you start from this side and move to this side, in both the cases, the length comes out to be 10 centimeter. Similarly, also one more thing here, this 10 centimeter is called the magnitude of length. The number, that 10 centimeter is called the magnitude of length. Okay, similarly, if you are standing on a weighing machine and the weighing machine shows 50 kg, that means the magnitude of your mass is 50 kg. Now, whether you stand facing north or whether you stand facing south, your mass will remain 50 kg. So again, mass does not depend upon direction. So it is a scalar quantity. Okay, now coming to the vector quantities. What are vector quantities? These are the physical quantities which have both direction and magnitude. For example, force and displacement. I have given two examples here, force and displacement. Displacement, we will be talking at length later on. Let us just understand what are vector quantities. For this, I will take an example. Suppose this is I told you here, one more example, force is a vector quantity. Suppose this is a big box, a heavy box. I tell you, you can open this box if you exert a force of 1 Newton on this box. I tell you, you can open this box if you exert a force of 1 Newton. Now, I didn't tell you the direction in which you have to exert the force. There are no instructions written on this box how to open this box. Now, you start exerting a force of 1 Newton in downward direction. Will you be able to open the box? You won't be able to open the box. If you are exerting a force of 1 Newton in the downward direction, you won't be able to open the force. However, if I tell you that you have to exert, in the first case, I did not tell you any direction. I gave you the incomplete information. Now, if I tell you that you have to exert a force of 1 Newton in the upward direction, then will you be able to open the box? Yes, you will be able to open the box. So, that means the force of 1 Newton is associated with the upward direction. Then only you can open this box. Now, just to have a better clarity, take one more example. Suppose this is any object lying over here. I exert a force of 2 Newton in this direction and 3 Newton again in this direction. So what will be the net force acting on this box? So I hope you all are aware of this concept. When the two forces act in the same direction, they are being added. And when they act in the opposite directions, they are subtracted to get the net force. This you might have studied in your class 8 as well. Now, we exert two forces, 2 Newton, force 1, 2 Newton, force 2, 3 Newton. So the net force acting on the box is 5 Newton towards right. Okay, so this is the direction in which the force of 5 Newton is acting. Now, consider the second case, in which we again exert a force of 2 Newton and 3 Newton, but in this way. 2 Newton in this direction and 3 Newton in this direction. Okay. Here in this case, the direction of the force matters. When both of them were acting in the same direction, they got added. Now, the two forces are acting in the opposite direction. So, they get subtracted. So the net force will come in which direction? In the left direction. Or I will say a net force of 1 Newton acts on the box. That means what is the magnitude of F net here, net force here? 5 Newton. And what is the direction? Towards right. The box towards right. And in this case, what is the magnitude of force? 1 Newton. And what is the direction? Towards left. So force is a vector quantity because it has a magnitude as well as a direction associated with it. I hope I'm clear till here. Next topic will be the distance and displacement, which I'll be taking in the next video. Thank you.